I'm Matthew Spalding, Associate Vice President and Dean for Hillsdale College here in Washington, D.C. Welcome to the Kirby Center for Constitutional Studies and Citizenship. It was over 25 years ago that Alan Bloom wrote a book called Closing of the American Mind, which criticized higher education for having failed at democracy and impoverishing the souls of today's students. He pointed out the paradox that the openness of relativism, the dominant philosophy of the modern academy and liberalism, leads, interestingly, to a closing to many of the greatest ideas in books of liberal education. Years after that, and since, we have seen this closing lead to an increasingly closed-mindedness, which is increasingly militant, especially on the campus. And that has come to threaten free speech and academic freedom. Fortunately, at Hillsdale College, things are a little different. The only trigger warnings we have is in our campus gun range. But our speaker today is going to explain that, and someone who has not only written about this subject, but experienced it firsthand, and we're very welcome, very happy to have her here with us. One of our students, in this case, a recent graduate of Hillsdale College, will be introducing today, Jenna Adamson. She's the class of 2015, a French and English major. She did the WIP program, which is the Washington Hillsdale Internship Program, in the spring of 2014, and she's currently working at National Affairs. Jenna.
Thank you, Dr. Spalding. Christina Hoff Summers earned her BA at NYU and her PhD in philosophy at Brandeis University. From 1980 to 1999, she was a philosophy professor at Clark University in Massachusetts, and from 1987 to 88, she spent a year as a visiting lecturer with the University of Pittsburgh Semester at Sea program. Dr. Summers is currently a resident scholar at the American Enterprise Institute, where she is best known for her critique of late 20th century feminism. She is the author of several books, including Who Stole Feminism, The War Against Boys, and Freedom Feminism, Its Surprising History and Why It Matters Today. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Christina Hoff Summers.
Thank you. Freedom is not an abstraction. It is real, and it affects our happiness, our ability to flourish, to lead fulfilling lives, and it cannot be taken for granted. It has to be learned, and it has to be earned, even fought for, in every generation. Each generation faces new temptations to trade personal freedoms for promised benefits. Benefits are abstractions, and usually abstractions that turn out to be passing fantasies. Well, this afternoon, I am going to describe a group of crusading authoritarians who have recently gained prominence on the college campus. Like their predecessors, they come armed with a set of urgent reasons why they need to abridge the basic freedoms of their fellow students. And they appear to be getting their way. I will describe these new crusaders. I will try to explain where they came from, what motivates them, and why are they suddenly so influential? Why are we suddenly hearing about the rape culture and advocacy statistics that used to be limited to the rarefied confines of gender studies departments? I am also going to, this will be the briefest part of my talk, suggest solutions because I'm not entirely confident in what to do in the face of hysteria. But I'm going to describe these new crusaders to you as best I can. I am convinced that the millennial generation is going to have to do what previous generations have done. They're going to have to rise up and take back their democratic freedoms. Well, who are these authoritarian crusaders? I encountered great numbers of them just a few weeks ago when I was an invited speaker at Georgetown, at UCLA, as well as Oberlin College. Now, I have been lecturing on college campuses for more than 20 years. I have never seen anything like what's going on today. Now, I, for those who don't know, I am a defender of a moderate equality feminism. I am a strong proponent of women's liberation and believe that the first and most of the second wave of feminism are just a great American success story. Women, for the most part, we're liberated. And to call contemporary women, as is often the case in today's gender studies environment, to call contemporary America a patriarchy, a male hegemony, or a rape culture, to me this is absurd. This is what I believe, but I'm often criticized by hardline grievance feminists who believe that American women are a victim class. And no amount of evidence can persuade them that they are wrong. Their views appear not to be falsifiable in any conceivable universe. Women are a victim class. My pleas for moderation, these are not appreciated on campus. But in the past, the grievance feminists would either boycott my talks, they would sometimes organize counter events, there were usually some antics. However, in many cases, they would just come to debate me, and that was great, that was fine. Sometimes we'd even go out for drinks and continue to argue and maybe even become friends. Well, this is not happening today, because today's campus feminists, even before I arrive, on social media and throughout, you know, in the campus newspaper, there are frantic notices about my presence and how I am a threat to their mental health. At both Oberlin and Georgetown, they organized safe spaces. These are safe rooms where students who might have been panicked by my arguments, where they could flee for comfort and according to the Oberlin Review, you can look a lot of it, it's just worth going looking at the articles before and after my visit to Oberlin. Look at these frenetic letters and op-eds. But apparently 35 people and a dog went to the to the safe room while I was speaking. Now at both I'll talk mainly about Georgetown and Oberlin because it was the most theatrical at these campuses, but the rooms were packed. There was a lot of nervous energy. I was somewhat nervous because I saw they were not happy. And there were angry flyers everywhere and trigger warnings about what they were about to hear. Typical flyers at Oberlin: free speech does not mean hate speech. Go home and take your internalized misogyny with you. What bothered me most is they took the names. I had been invited to Oberlin by the College Libertarians and Republicans. Not a large group, but they invited me. The students, the vigilantes, I will call them, took all of their names and had posters, you know, that these are rape apologists, and singled them out. And I saw they were very upset. And there was a lot of yelling and hooting during my talk, but for me, the very worst moment at Oberlin was when this kindly philosophy professor sort of stood up and just urged the crowd to calm down, be civil. And he was heckled and screamed at, and then somebody just said, sit down, in the most uncivilized way, very rude way. It was a mob, and here was a humane individual just asking for courtesy. This is how he was treated at Oberlin College. And I'm quite certain that if these people ever came to power, they would certainly have banned me from campus, probably for life, and for good reason from their point of view. But if my presence made the students feel unsafe and endangered, the school administration came to a different conclusion, and at both Georgetown and Oberlin, they assigned police escorts. And after my lecture at Oberlin, two nervous police women escorted me from the podium, you know, looking around. I was not afraid. I mean, gender activists don't have a record of violence. I wasn't as scared, but they were. I think it was the postings on Facebook that seemed a bit worrisome for them. But I was put in a police car with some students, and we were taken off campus and deposited at a restaurant where we had dinner. Well, It's easy to laugh at all of this. The melodrama, the psychobabble, the self-involvement is alarming. But let me be clear about a few things before I continue about the trigger warnings and the traumatized students and so forth. I am sure that there are young women and men at Oberlin, at Georgetown, probably on every campus in the country. There are some students who have experienced trauma, and they do need to be taken care of. And I hope that our colleges have psychological services to help them. But there is no evidence that this is more than a tiny minority of students. And it's unlikely that a visiting scholar with dissenting views on feminism is going to trigger PTSD. Now, I think that this movement is not really about protecting vulnerable students. I think that it's just a new way to assert power and control over others. It's a way of asserting your cause without having to bother with evidence and argument. You just shame people, intimidate them, silence them, and you do it with psychodrama. Now, I'll add one other comment. I have never denied the reality of campus sexual assault. I think it's a horrific crime. It happens. But I have questioned exaggerated statistics. And by the way, I wasn't at Oberlin or Georgetown or any of these campuses. I wasn't there to talk about sexual assault. But the students found out that I had said some politically incorrect things. What were these harmful, dangerous thoughts of mine? Well, I do contest exaggerated statistics, because I don't think they help victims. Quite the contrary. It's because I take the crime of assault so seriously that I think we need serious research. We need sober statistics. And there's just no good evidence that liberal enclaves like Oberlin or Swarthmore or Georgetown or Wesleyan, that these are rape cultures. Now, Oberlin is the most extreme, but what I saw there is happening on campuses everywhere, and the more elite and expensive the school, the more likely it is a hotbed of trigger warnings, safe spaces, microaggression defense initiatives, and mob justice. Let me briefly explain what some of these phenomena are, should they be new to you. Trigger warnings developed in the feminist blogosphere, and they typically appeared at the beginnings of articles on websites where people got together to discuss their some trauma they may have had. And so they would say, warning, we're going to talk about assault, or we're going to talk about eating disorders, or we're going to talk about, you know, suicide. But these promptly moved from the blogs to newspapers to the classroom. And professors at schools like Oberlin and Rutgers, UCSB, Columbia, they have been urged now to place trigger warnings on their class syllabi, to warn students, if you're going to be, this was it, I think, Rutgers and at UCSB, professors were told, if you're signing books like The Great Gatsby or Huckleberry Finn, Things Fall Apart, place trigger warnings on the reading list because they have content that could trigger, you know, PTSD or panic. Students will end up running from the room in a state of anxiety, collapse, and all sorts of furious warnings about what would happen. Student leaders at Columbia just a few weeks ago really shocked their professors. And by the way, the liberal professors are terrified. They don't know what to do. They're not used to challenging the politically correct left. On the other hand, they know this is wrong, and they're scared. They're now writing about it. And at Oberlin, some of the professors told me that they were actually scared because they could say something and make a student uncomfortable and end up, as one wrote in an anonymous blog, I could see my office suddenly being occupied by frantic students carrying mattresses or you know, it would trigger a Twitter mob to demand my head on a platter. At Columbia, which they have a tradition in teaching the great books, well, apparently the great books are just full of materials that can be triggering, and professors were warned to be careful in assigning them, to warn students, and here's the quote, that these books could marginalize student identities in the classroom. At a recent feminist conference in London, the attendees, who were all female student leaders from colleges around the country, including Oxford and Cambridge, they warned the members of the audience to please refrain from clapping because, as the conferees explained, clapping can trigger anxiety, perhaps panic, in speakers, in participants, in everybody. Instead, the audience was urged to express approval by something called feminist jazz hands. So when you like what the reader's saying, this is madness. Now, for the record, trigger warnings have no basis in psychological fact, scientific fact. They developed out of feminist theory. Richard McNally is a Harvard psychologist and an expert on anxiety disorders. And he recently published a review of the relevant research. And he determined that if anything, trigger warnings are actually harmful. And I won't go into details, but if a student genuinely has PTSD, the worst thing you can do is to allow the trauma to define their lives and to encroach. What you do is you gradually expose them to triggering events. But of course, we never know what will trigger a traumatic reaction. So all of this is absurd and not based on anything other than a kind of bitter ideology. Trigger warnings have created a hostile environment for critical thinking and free expression. And as I said, the professors are now worried. They're, you know, having suddenly to, I'm thinking, like, I don't know, in philosophy, I'm teaching introduction to metaphysics, I don't know, or logical analysis, I try to think, I guess there are no occasions for trigger warnings there, but you can't be sure. In addition to the trigger warnings, today's campus feminists are committed to creating safe spaces for one another. So when Brown University hosted a debate on, they had a debate on statistics about sexual assault, and one person was defending the idea that 20% of college women are victims, and another person was there, a libertarian feminist, Wendy McElroy, and she was questioning those statistics. Well, this created pandemonium, and they set up a room. And again, they were accused of invalidating experience. Apparently, if someone invalidates your experience, it's traumatizing. So the safe room came equipped. This was described in the New York Times in an article by Judith Shulevitz. The safe room came equipped with cookies, coloring books, bubbles, Play-Doh, calming music, pillows and blankets, and a video of frolicking puppies. You know, I read this and think, this is what women's liberation has come to. Anyway, I host a weekly internet video program called The Factual Feminist, and I spend no more than 5 minutes correcting a feminist myth of the week, or a feminist mistake, or a fallacy, and it's been quite successful. Some of them have had more than 500,000 views. So I'm educating someone, or triggering a lot of people, I'm not sure. But gender activists at Oberlin and Georgetown and UCLA and even Yale, where I spoke, they didn't act out in Yale, although we'll talk about that later. But at Georgetown and Oberlin, they consider my corrections of their cherished fantasies to be a form of trauma-inducing hate speech. And that's why the campus visits of a sort of bookish think tank number cruncher now necessitates trigger warnings and warnings from the rooftops and safe spaces for emotionally endangered students. Now, today's campus activists are on constant alert for microaggressions committed by others. Now, what is a microaggression? These are unintended comments or actions that convey your ignorance, hostility, or dismissal towards individuals belonging to a marginalized group. And on campus and on the internet, you can be called out for being microaggressive. And in some cases, there's some legitimacy. Some people do need to be reminded not to be insensitive or, you know, lacking in tact. And I've seen many occasions where I wanted to correct someone from something they said, but I refrained. Well, they don't refrain. They call them out as microaggressions. But here's the thing. They're not just correcting solecisms or, you know, people that are just being rude or something. You can be called out for criticizing feminism. That's microaggressive. Or for suggesting that there might be differences on average between men and women, differences between major microaggression. And of course, all jokes are out of bounds. Any joke about sex and gender, my God, forget it. Humor is not a strong point of grievance feminism. Now, I'm not going to spend a lot of time explaining why all of this is worrisome. Just three quick observations. Since the time of Socrates, education has been synonymous with debate, inquiry, challenge. If the universities replace the ideal of rigorous and free intellectual inquiry with safety, they will have lost their reason for being. Second, all of this is massively embarrassing to women, to feminism. This safe space, microaggression, trigger warning movement conveys the idea that women are like wounded, little wounded birds who can't cope with life. It's regressive. It's the opposite of what a women's movement should be. It's the opposite of women's empowerment. It's fainting couch feminism. Third and finally, it's passive aggressive. It is a bald assertion of power in the name of vulnerability. Where did this come from? And what do they want? Well, why are we suddenly hearing so much about it? Well, first I'll tell you where it came from and then why now. Grievance feminism, it's been here for a long time. And so have I, and I've been watching it since the 1980s. And I remember in the summer of 1985, a philosophy professor at the City University of New York, Virginia Held, she announced in the premier journal of philosophy at the time, maybe it's not now, but at the time it was, hardest to publish in that journal, she announced that feminist theorists had initiated a revolution, an intellectual revolution, comparable, and these are her words, comparable to those of Copernicus, Darwin, and Freud. Indeed, said Held, quote, some feminists think the latest revolution will be even more profound. Now, what was it? What did they discover? They discovered, as she explained, the sex gender system, a pervasive system whereby men oppress women. And she wrote this, now that the sex gender system has become visible to us, we see it everywhere. Now, my problem from the beginning was that I just didn't see it everywhere. But they were like the Dutch naturalist Van Leeuwenhoek looking through a microscope and suddenly seeing this predatory jungle. Well, they were looking at society through the prism of some twisted theory of oppression, and they saw oppression. They saw women's subordination everywhere. Well, they believed that every human achievement bears the impress of patriarchy. Literature, philosophy, science, music, language. It's not enough to reform a few laws. They dismiss liberal feminists like me because they said, oh, she just wants to reform a few laws or change a few customs. That won't do. The entire system must be taken down. It must be dismantled. You can't just, they like to say this, this makes them laugh. You say, you can't just add women and stir. You must, you know, radically, we need a gender revolution. Now, I used to call this gender feminism because they believe in the sex gender system. Now I call it grievance feminism. It grew out of, it just does not come out of the European Enlightenment. This is not about human, about rationality and dignity and liberty. As this movement developed out of the radical politics of the 60s, as well as the philosophy of Karl Marx and his modern day heirs, Herbert Marcuse, Frantz Fanon, Michel Foucault. One prominent grievance feminist defined the sex gender system this way. She said, quote, it is that complex system whereby bisexual infants are transformed into male and female gender personalities, the one destined to command, the other to obey. I remember reading that definition to my husband, and he said, which one commands and which obeys? But never mind. Now, it's easy to see why some young women find this enthralling. I mean, grievance feminism is exciting. Conspiracy theories have their attractions. And this particular paranoid view of the world, it offers them a chance to be gender warriors in a battle for liberation. Now, mainstream moderate equity feminism, that can't compete with grievance feminism when it comes to excitement and camaraderie, fervor, political activism, the quest for power. I don't offer that. You can't compete with, if you have young women who are, and young people sometimes do get carried away, but pick up a gender studies textbook or visit a women's center or look at the syllabus of a typical feminist theory class, and you're likely to find elaborate theories about the inner workings of the, and these are the words of bell hooks, the imperialist, capitalist, patriarchal society. Today, the fashion is intersectional feminism, and according to this theory, most of us are oppressed under the imperialist, capitalist patriarchy, that's a given, but in all kinds of different ways and to different degrees, depending on your race, your class, your ethnicity, your sexual orientation, your age, your body size, your blood type, or maybe not blood type, but what would that be? I don't know. This approach might have been an improvement over other schools of feminism that tended to view women as a monolithic group and men as a monolithic group. You know, at least they were starting to look at individuals, but it's turned out that it's equally removed from reality and even more bizarre in its way, and it's not new. I saw intersectional feminism. I saw it in the beginning. I saw where it was born. In 1992, I attended a conference of the National Women's Studies Association, and because I was writing a paper about what was going on in women's studies, and they weren't that happy that I was there because I'd already written something somewhat critical, so there was all sorts of caucusing about what to do about her, and I came with my sister, in the biological sense of the word. My sister Louise went with me. She's a psychologist, just to watch this conference in Austin, Texas, and the theme of the conference was anger, grievance, and healing. And participants, we immediately were told to break down into our various grievance categories according to your anger and healing needs. So you had groups like Jewish women, Jewish lesbians, Asian American women, Asian American lesbians, African American women, lesbians, old women, disabled women, fat women, women whose sexuality is in transition. None of these groups proved stable. Even at our conference, they started subdividing. Like a mad process of mitosis, a kind of victimology, spinning out of control. That day, the very first day, a group of very bitter women separated from all the other group and demanded that they have their own forum, and these were women with allergies. They, it's not funny, that's marginalizing. They issued a set of demands about, next year we demand that no one wear clothes that have been dry cleaned or hairspray or other irritants to the conference. This, here's the thing, the spirit of that, my sister was found it clinically fascinating. As I said, she said, they seem to be borderline personalities or something. The spirit of that conference is the spirit of today's intersectional feminism. The spirit of that conference is alive in the trigger warnings, the safe space, the microaggression monitors. Now, I want to say one thing, in case there be any confusion. There are some serious scholars in women's studies. Many departments include a fair number of solid, non-ideological scholars who offer straightforward courses in women's history, in women in literature. I recently wrote a book called Freedom Feminism, where I discussed the kind of lost continent of conservative and libertarian feminists who aren't part of the feminist pantheon. They're not celebrated in Women's History Month, but they were there. They're fascinating. They're wonderful. And I depended on these wonderful scholars, mostly at UCLA, in women's studies, women's historians, that have written so beautifully and just eloquently about 18th century proto-feminists, the Blue Stockings and various groups who were somewhat conservative, but who changed the world in very positive ways. As I said, left out of the feminist canon, but thank you, women's studies scholars at UCLA and at Brandeis and other places that were so helpful to me. So I'm not, I don't want everyone to walk and think women's studies is out of control. But here's the problem. The grievance collectors are there in most of the departments, and they set the tone, and they set the agenda. And over the years, I have looked carefully at grievance feminist claims about everything about women in violence, women in eating disorders, pay equity, women in education. And what I have found is that in most, not all, but most, the victim statistics are just wrong. They're misleading. They're confused. Some are outright false. What I'm saying is that if you take a typical women's studies class or an intro feminist theory 101, typically you will encounter a set of completely baseless statistics, relentless flow of misinformation. Now, some people criticize me for talking about feminist misinformation mistakes. They say, why pick on feminists? All books have mistakes. All groups exaggerate. My complaint with the grievance feminist research is not so much that the authors make mistakes. It's that the mistakes are impervious to criticism. They are beyond the reach of rational analysis. They do not get corrected. And I know this. I had a very bitter exchange with a feminist scholar from UCLA who wrote the leading text. I think it's called Domestic Violence Law. It's full of mistakes, outrageous historical howlers. And it went into the third edition with all the mistakes right there, even though I had told her and given her the sources. Because in this, if you are a card-carrying grievance feminist, you automatically dismiss a critic as a crank. There has to be an agenda there. Anyone that would question a feminist victim statistic is by definition disqualified as a critic. That works well. Now, reasonable people can debate these statistics about women and violence, women and with the pay gap, women and self-esteem, women and so forth. All of that can be debated. In these classes, they're not interested in debate. They can be counted on to ignore studies that show low rates of victimization, no matter how rigorous they may be, no matter how fair-minded, and they can be counted on to report on studies that show high levels of victimization, no matter how dubious or how questionable the source. So what I and other critics have found is not just some mistakes in the women's studies, in the gender studies canon. We have found a body of egregiously false information. But this information has consequences. As a regular campus lecturer, I routinely, even before the trigger warners, I routinely encountered young women, mostly young women, sometimes young men, who have imbibed this grievance propaganda. They're generally, they're kind of intelligent, sensitive, socially concerned young people, but they have come to regard this grim feminist worldview as incontrovertible truth. And most seem to be unaware that they're is a reasonable, empirically based arguments contrary to what they believe. Now, this is the opposite of what a university should be. If you go back and read John Stuart Mill on liberty, he didn't merely talk about the need for freedom of expression. He talked about intellectual freedom in the deepest sense, and he warned that ideas have to be freely and openly debated, because if they are not, they become dead dogmas. And he insisted that an intellectually free person had the right and the responsibility to put himself in the mental position of those who think differently. And he added that dissident ideas are, it's best if you are, you encounter them from someone who actually believes them and someone who can present them in their most plausible and persuasive form. So Mill was a great, it was part of our heritage of liberty to have centers of education and learning where ideas and dissident ideas freely and openly debated. In too many universities today, students, they never, I don't want to say never, but probably never hear arguments from libertarians or conservatives, even sometimes moderate liberal ideas in women's studies department are looked down upon, frowned upon. This is in many departments at the universities, but doubly true in gender studies. Grievance feminism has tenure. It has a monopoly on the discourse on women in our university, and its dead dogmas are taken seriously. Now, history is one long lesson in the dangers of combining moral fervor and misinformation. If you have good information and you have moral energy, we get the civil rights movement. You get human progress. But what if you have bad information, propaganda? That toxic combination breeds zealotry, fanaticism. And on our campuses and in some of our women's groups, that's what we have. intolerance of dissent, vigilantism, shouting down speakers, and all of this supported by this foundation of propaganda, of false statistics. But now I want to turn the corner and address the question of why did all this suddenly become so newsworthy? Because as I said, this has been going on campuses since the 80s, maybe even the 70s in some places. Now the trigger warnings are new, but conspiracy theories about the patriarchy, the sex gender system, even the all-encompassing rape culture, that has flourished in the academy for decades. But until recently, it remained there. What brought it into the mainstream? Why are we suddenly hearing about the rape culture? How did it get into the public square? Now, of course, social media has played a part in the proliferation of feminist blogs and websites. But I don't believe we would be where we are today. I don't believe that what happened to me at Oberlin, Georgetown, and other places, I don't believe that would happen if it were not for a specific event in 2010. That year, a left-leaning organization called the Center for Public Integrity, they teamed up with reporters at National Public Radio, and they produced a massive study describing a hidden rape and sexual harassment culture on campus. The director at the Center for Public Integrity described it as a nightmare. What's happening to our daughters? Now, as I have said, campus sexual assault, harassment, these are genuine problems, but this report made it seem as if our colleges were these catastrophic centers of male predation and cruelty and female helplessness and suffering. Not only that, this report, which had, you know, the cachet of coming from this respected Center for Public Integrity and NPR, I mean, Joseph Shapiro on Morning Edition, you listen to him and his voice, and he was reporting these findings, and it sounds, of course it has to be true, he wouldn't be reporting it. It wasn't true. This report was the worst kind of advocacy research. It was full of unfounded statistics, manipulative anecdotes. I have no time to go into more detail about it. I'll just say that before the Rolling Stone made headlines with its media hoax about the UVA fraternity gang rape, NPR and the Center for Public Media, they carried out a far more consequential hoax. Hoax isn't quite the right word. It was a reckless and irresponsible case of advocacy journalism. But here's why it was so consequential. The NPR public integrity team, they took their findings by the way, in this study, they not only uncovered this epidemic of rape and predation, but they said campus officials are doing nothing and the federal government is doing nothing. They're re-victimizing the women. So this was an indictment of everybody from NPR, from the Center for Public Integrity. So NPR and the report, they went directly to the Department of Education and they confronted the Assistant Secretary of Education, Ruslan Ali, with evidence of massive malfeasance. And Secretary Ali promised action. And I mean, she believed the report. She was already going to make some changes, but it's very well documented. And I wrote this in an article in the Daily Beast, if anyone wants details, but forget that. But the education, Ruslan Ali promised them, I'm going to do something about it. She was motivated. Now, the educational equity law, Title IX, protects students against gender discrimination. But as the report said, what could be more discriminatory than a hostile climate created by sexual violence? So Secretary Ali, leading the Office for Civil Rights, this is the agency responsible for enforcing Title IX, on April 4th, 2011, she sent out a now famous Dear Colleague letter, at least famous among college officials and students and those of us who worry about basic rights on campus. She sent out this letter telling the officials, look, we've got a plague of abuse on campus. And she told universities, you've got to have trials. You've got to, you know, convict people under the lowest standard of proof. It's called preponderance of evidence. There was not a single word about civil liberties. There wasn't a word about freedom of expression. And initially, they defined harassment. I mean, even if someone could overhear something that they found uncomfortable with sexual content, these could be a basis for a charge. Now, as I said, there wasn't a word about civil rights and basic freedom of expression and so forth. NPR and the Center for Public Integrity, along with the Office of Civil Rights, they gave credibility and legitimacy to the conspiratorial, safe space, trigger warnings people. They empowered them. Because right after that, these young women were turning up everywhere. And suddenly everybody wanted to write about it. Because the imprimatur of NPR and the Center for Public Integrity, it had to be true. So these young women read about it. They could make a federal case out of what they learned in their gender studies class. And schools had to worry never to dismiss their complaints, no matter how baseless or absurd, because they could face a federal investigation. So the term rape culture, which, as I said, was previously limited to gender theory seminars, it entered the national lexicon. And that was largely because of that Dear Colleague letter. Before long, otherwise sensible people came to believe that Yale, Swarthmore, University of Michigan, that these were among the most dangerous places on earth for women. Colleges rushed to meet the new requirements. Dozens of apparently falsely accused young men were subjected to kangaroo court proceedings and expelled from college. I forget the latest number. I think there's 60, maybe more, lawsuits. Young men that were driven to, it takes a lot to sue your school. They're suing their school for this travesty of these hearings. By 2014 and 15, the panic produced outbursts of extreme zealotry. Young women, you know, we had this young woman carrying her mattress around at Columbia University, and she was permitted to do that, to humiliate. And it was a kind of vigilante action against a young man who had been found not guilty by campus tribunals, using the lowest standard of proof. On college campuses, students were triggered suddenly by songs, by works of art. At Wellesley College, somebody put a statue of a sort of frumpy guy in the quad, and he was just wearing, I don't know, boxer shorts or something, and the girls were falling apart. Not all of them, but a number of them wanted it removed because they were triggered. It wasn't a great work of art. My aesthetics were triggered, but how annoying for them to carry on this way. What was much worse, the songs and the statue, works of art, trigger warnings and works of literature. You can go on YouTube. I don't recommend you do it because it's dismaying and depressing. But you can find examples of speakers on campus, and far worse than what happened to me. I was at least allowed to speak. People were hooting and hollering and carrying on, but I was allowed to speak. There are now campuses where a speaker like me, the gender warriors come and they chant, and they get louder and louder until you can't speak. You have to cancel the event. So this is going on. This is, even The Nation magazine is a little worried about, they say they're behaving like little red guards. And when The Nation is saying that, we have a problem. I think The Nation was talking about another group of fanatics on Twitter, but this is about the Academy. Now, when Rolling Stone published its apocryphal article about a sadistic and premeditated fraternity gang rape at the University of Virginia, many who should have known better took it seriously. When I read it, I immediately saw that it was a kind of gothic fantasy based on these twisted theories and false statistics that had been percolating along for years. This was the worldview of gender feminism. But now it was in Rolling Stone. And the New York Times believed it. And a lot of people did, until it fell apart in a matter of days. It was nurtured by poorly designed studies, by panic. And of course, political figures got into the fray. Senator Gillibrand, Claire McCaskill, organized, and bringing in these young women. to Congress. And these young women, they do have the spirit of, it was almost as if that crazy conference I attended in 1992 with my sister, with these injured groups with their healing circles and carrying on, I think these might be their daughters or their heirs. One of them, the mattress girl, was invited by Senator Gillibrand to the State of the Union. She didn't bring her mattress. But anyway, Title IX was passed in order to give women equal educational opportunities. But thanks to this April 11th, your colleague letter brought to us by NPR and the Center for Public Integrity, it has been interpreted to mean the schools have to make sure that they're safe. They provide a safe place for even the most hypersensitive, like neurasthenic person among them. They have to feel safe and comfortable. Well, before considering what could be done to stem the tide of gender fanaticism on campus, I'm just going to quickly consider an argument against some of what I've been saying, which I've heard many times. Some people will say to me, look, I admit some of this is crazy. I don't like the trigger warnings and the safe spaces. It's a bit silly. But there is too much sexual violence on campus. It needed a correction. Yeah, they're going a little overboard, but rape and harassment are so terrible. Maybe we need to go overboard. Maybe we need extreme solutions, extreme direct action to solve an extreme problem. So they're drawing attention to a real problem. Maybe they're not doing it in the right way, but it's in the direction of progress. Here is why that argument is completely wrong. It is precisely because campus sexual assault is a genuine problem that people should avoid antics, hyperbole, hysteria. These reactions get in the way of solutions. Hysteria, which I personally witnessed at Oberlin and Georgetown, these breed chaos, confusion, mob justice. They claim innocent victims, they undermine social trust, they distract attention from genuine cases of abuse. And remember, the hysteria is not only distracting us from finding effective solutions to campus assault, it's turning our campuses into hostile environments for freedom and for education. Well, what are we going to do to stop it? How can we stop a contagion of, it? To me, it seems like hysteria. When I was at Oberlin and talking to some of the students, this is strong, but I think sustainable, I felt I was dealing with members of a cult. Well, what can we do to deprogram them? I'm not sure of that. I am not, as a philosopher, I have no training in, I did look up psychiatric literature on contagions and hysteria and solutions and studied the Salem witch trials rather carefully. What are we going to do to stop this movement, grievance feminism? I'm going to race through these because I want to open this up for discussion. So very quickly, and then I will subside. First thing I think we all have to do, in any way we can, make the case for freedom. I said in the beginning, every generation has the challenge. And we're here, especially the millennials. I speak at a lot of campuses, and I try to directly tell these students, you don't want to be the generation where freedom went to die. That should not be your legacy. Now, as a philosophy professor, I'm naive, but I have great faith in the power of rational discourse. I have changed my views when confronted with counter evidence. And by the way, whenever I go to the campuses, I tell them, I know about confirmation bias. We all have a tendency to embrace anything that reinforces what we already believe, and we have a built-in tendency to dismiss and not take seriously, discount anything that undermines our beliefs. And I try strenuously to fight that. I see it in myself, I try to fight it. But these are this is about being rational, about being reasonable, and I have faith in that. There was a very wise person who once said, the voice of reason is small, but it's persistent. So reason can prevail over madness, but only if reasonable people speak up. So today, at least on the campus, the forces of unreason are more organized and they're more vocal. So reason needs a lobby. I urge all of you to become part of it in any way you can. Political reform. We are going to need to see political and legal challenges to those changes made in Title IX on April 4th, 2011. You would have a lot of support from colleges because it's thrown them into complete chaos and havoc and costing a fortune to do everything that this letter says they have to do. Now, be prepared if you challenge this politically. Be prepared for a frenzied reaction from the safe spacers, and a lot of the media will take their side. On the other hand, there are a growing number of responsible journalists who know something has gone badly wrong on the campus. And as I said, even The Nation magazine is worried about the safe spacers. I don't think anybody is comfortable with the trigger warners except the trigger warners. Number three, more lawsuits. Students and professors whose rights to free expression and due process have been compromised need to turn to the courts. And this is happening. There's a group called the Foundation for Individual Rights in Education, FIRE. I think I'm on the board, so full disclosure. But it's a nonprofit. It's kind of an ACLU for academic freedom. And it has conservatives and liberals. And it's nonpartisan, but it's pro-freedom, and it's awesome. And anytime a school tries to have a speech code or do something crazy to abridge a student's basic rights, they have lawyers who write very threatening letters and intimidate with legally threatening, not personally threatening. And they were now helping students to sue. And I mention lawsuits because as it's well known that the Salem witch trials, they began to wind down when wealthy and influential people started to be accused. And there's one historical account of a worthy gentleman from Boston who was accused rather late in the frenzy, and he went directly to court and sued his accusers for slander, for a lot of money. And according to some historical accounts, that was decisive in stopping the hysteria. People didn't realize you could have to face consequences for this. They should know there will be consequences if they slander people. Finally, humor, fainting couch, safe space, grievance feminism. It's just an open invitation for satire and parody. So humor can be a very potent weapon. Someone recently placed a song parody about my visit to Oberlin College. They placed it on YouTube. It's entitled, "Please Don't Put Us in the Real World." And it's allegedly sung by the Oberlin College Choir. I don't think it is, but they've denied it's them. I'm sure it's not them. I don't know. I'm surprised they haven't taken credit for it because it's had 70, 80, 90,000 views. People like it, and it's being written about, but no one, I don't know who wrote it, but it's very clever. "Please Don't Put Me in the Real World." I think that song has had more publicity than certainly my lecture, so it's a good way to draw attention to your cause. Feminist propaganda, irresponsible journalism, politicians willing to bend the law to address a phantom catastrophe. What a mess. And what a hostile environment for learning, for happiness. At this very moment, campus officials across the country are quietly amending the U.S. Constitution. And freedom of expression is being replaced by the right not to be made uncomfortable. Due process is being treated as a barrier to justice rather than the essence of justice. Armies of gender apparatchiks are monitoring and policing speech, ideas, humor, even clapping. George Orwell from 1984, if you remember the Junior Anti-Sex League, they've set up shop right in our midst. So today's millennials are going to have to decide. Are they going to be the generation that stands by helplessly or even applauds as their basic freedoms are stripped away? My guess is that the millennials, like generations before them, will eventually rally and defend their liberties. I already see signs of resistance. I just hope it comes sooner rather than later and it grows quickly because the victim industrial complex is tightening its grip. Our institutions of higher learning have to be open and free places of intellectual diversity and challenge. Today, they are not. They have been called islands of repression in a sea of freedom. Well, it's time to liberate the islands. Thank you. And both clapping and jazz hands are welcome.
Administrators were kind of too scared to let thinkers like you.
Which is your alma mater?
Georgetown. So, Professor, where are scholars supposed to go if their administrators are too scared of speakers like you coming to debate and discuss issues that make others uncomfortable on the ivory towers? And will you return to a campus like Georgetown if you're treated like that?
Oh, well, I would. I would, because I don't like bullies. And this is, if I were really scared to death, I probably wouldn't. I'm not afraid. It's an unpleasant experience, somewhat. It's also kind of interesting. So I recommend it. And you have to do it. And I want more. I really am disappointed in college faculty because they have tenure and they're still scared. It's so strange because I thought the purpose of tenure was that you were liberated to speak your mind, and yet they don't do it. So what can we do? Well, I think we have to keep doing what we're doing. We have, it's interesting because I grew up very liberal, and I'm still think of myself as a kind of hippie protester, flower child. But this put me on the side of conservatives on so many issues because it's conservatives and libertarians who are defending freedom, defending humor, defending fun, even sex. What happened? It all switched. And there was a time all the comedians, you know, the right wing, I don't know, some right wing forces didn't want, you know, wanted to, the police, mayors, they wanted to arrest George Carlin or Lenny Bruce or something. Now it's conservatives defending the comedian. I saw a wonderful article by, I think it was Molly Hemingway in The Federalist saying, conservatives and libertarians, we have to form humor speakeasies. You know, not places where you go to drink, but places where you can go to laugh. You can tell jokes. You can be a dissident. You can try out, you know. So I think we just have to have fun. And although at some level I think it's probably this is going to require a civil war on the left. And I don't know if the leftists have the heart to fight it because the fear of looking a liberal, the fear of looking like Christina Hoff Sommers to many feminists, they don't want that. They can't do it. So that's why I talk a lot about the students. I think maybe the students have to push it. They need their own free speech movement and push their elders because the elders are timid. I mean, for years we thought this was going to be easy when we fought the first culture war. Then we had journalists on our side. The New York Times was on our side, and we won the arguments, but they won the assistant professorships quietly behind the scene, and now they're there, and now a whole generation have been educated by them, and they're out there with these ideas. So do anything you can to provide exposure to new ideas. And, of course, we have the Internet, so we can't complain about not having venues, but, again, people tend to read just what's reinforces their beliefs. To break that down. Jane.
Well, thank you so much. Two quick questions, but first I just want to say thank you, Christina, for going into these hotbeds of debate, and if it is debate, then it takes a lot personally. So thank you for being a warrior for truth, I would say. But my questions are, did you see anything as you move around these environments about Islam and how Islam treats women? And secondly, how do you connect this with the mob tactics of other places that we're watching as divisiveness comes up, starting with Wisconsin and what happened?
Right. These tactics of claiming that you are going to be panicked and triggered, they're being used by other groups. So I think recently at the University of Michigan, they wanted to show a film, what was the name of the film? American Sniper. And there was a brouhaha about that and how it would make the certain Muslim students feel uncomfortable and so forth. So, of course, that's going on and just terrible confrontation. Worse than I face because some of these people are willing. I've seen I think it was a police chief from New York who was practically, I don't even know, he was talking about, I forget where he was, but he was on a college campus and he was simply trying to talk about his experiences as a police chief in New York City, and protesters came, and he was not allowed to speak. He had to just leave the room, and so this is going on, and you can't understand why does the college administration, why do they permit it? And why aren't there consequences for doing something that's such a threat to the very purpose of the institution? So yes, it's going on in other areas. I think there are a lot of women on campus and a lot of people that sort of go along with this movement, so it may be the most forceful, the one you hear about all the time. And there are a lot of young men who are subject to their various protocols and their workshops and corrections. And so young men now are presumed guilty. In fact, at the moment they arrive on campus, it's almost as if there are proto-rapists and proto-survivors. And the proto-rapists are the boys and the survivors are the girls. And shocking and demeaning workshops and seminars and assemblies and goings-on. So that's hard to miss if you're on campus. The other's probably hard to miss depending on the size of the campus and what's going on. But then you mentioned something else. What was the first part? Oh, yes. This is what I found sad. Well, there are many things I find sad, obviously, about what's going on. But I'm so shocked at how narcissistic this is on the campuses. There's so much going wrong in the world. There's so many problems that need solution. And let's suppose you are committed to the emancipation of women. Well, I've been to several international women's conferences, and I have met women from places like Egypt and Yemen and even Iran, and they are fighting for what we won in both first and second wave feminism. And I have met women coming from societies that have not only had two major waves of feminism as we have, they have not had so much as a ripple. And they want to make common cause with American women. And we did organize and liberate ourselves, and they see us as inspiring. Why are these young women at Oberlin College, at Wellesley, at these elite, it's all on their own, how I've been injured, and poor little me. This is a disaster, because it's so they're not there. If you see what's happening with women in Iran or what's happening today in Egypt and Yemen, why aren't they interested? In fact, they're more if you bring it up, they're more likely to say that you're violating some principle of multiculturalism by being critical. And so there are feminists who say that it's just part of the capitalist, patriarchal, colonialist mentality to feel that we have anything to impart to other societies. But I happen to believe that there are universal ideals. And I remember one young woman from Cambodia, she was from, I will call it Burma. She was from Burma, and she had been in jail for 10 years because she'd taken out a petition for democracy. And she got out, and what did she do the next day? She started handing out petitions for democracy. She was the bravest person I'm aware of meeting. And then she said to the audience, and this was Westerners in New York, she said, democracy isn't only for the West. It's for mankind. That was her commitment. This was like a little, Patrick Henry that I was meeting from Burma. So, and those are exciting people. These are morally, it's electrifying. Why aren't our students meeting her? Why aren't they meeting and agitating for liberty and for education, for freedom, for women, for everyone across the world? And so that's the price we're paying, is we have a generation that activism is inward. It's for me. It's all part of the me generation, or I don't know if it's the helicopter parenting, the self-esteem. There are many, many causes. But I will tell you that entitled generation, they're not all like that. But the ones that are on these universities, that little enclave, very entitled, preoccupied, everything always, went the way you thought it should. And if it didn't, it was a crisis. They've carried that into their college life, and they seem to be blind to the needs of people outside themselves.